Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Peter Erskine. I'm honored and delighted to present this next gentleman. We're at the start of all the presentations here. A little brief personal history. Terry and I met 46 years ago. I just joined the Kenton Band and we played at his high school. Shortly thereafter, he was a student at one of the Kenton summer camps, and he brought up an arrangement that he wrote. And I remember him, and I remember the chart. It was a terrific piece of music. And his love for Kenton has only grown over all these years. And he's the leading scholar and archivist, and he's done incredibly important work in preserving and cataloging Stan's music, his career, and the contributions that all the musicians who worked with Stan made. A professor at the Washington and Lee University for 23 years, and an expert in all things Kenton, I present Terry Vosbein.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you all for coming out on this fun morning as the jazz event gets cracking along. I'm really happy to tell you that I'm talking to you about something, as Peter said, that I've loved since I was a teenager. I didn't come at this as a scholar, I came out of this as a curious musician who wanted to learn more. Somewhere along the way, I had collected so much information, I was looking for a way to put it together, share it. I had an intensive database that I collected from the collections at the University of North Texas, where Stan Kenton donated his scores and photos and many other things. I was approached by the University of North Texas Press. They were looking for a book about Stan Kenton. And I thought that the kind of materials that I was collecting were not really appropriate for a book form, primarily because two reasons. One, there's so much material. And two, it gets updated almost daily as I get new information. That conversation with the University of North Texas Press led to my suggesting that they get in touch with Michael Spark in England. And they published, they wound up publishing a wonderful biography by Michael. So I decided at that point that perhaps the website was the way to go. So what I created with All Things Kenton is, think of it as a museum, as a very specific museum with lots and lots of rooms. The building may not look very big when you first see it, but just start walking down the halls, and one hall will open up into another hall, and you'll find that the museum is far larger than you expected. I'm going to give you a little tour through it. First, I'll give you some background, and then we'll dive into the website itself. As I do that, imagine that I'm this excited curator walking down the hall with you all, and that I may see doors as we're walking that I say, oh, come on in, you got to see this. So my goal is just to kind of share. It's such a big site, I'm just giving you some introduction to it and showing you some of my favorite things and giving you a little bit of my method. We'll skip right over that sound for now. You all recognize that big F minor chord. Anyway, it's a gigantic site. It's over 500 individually created pages on that. And so when I have to update, or if one of the plugins I use gets updated, frequently I have to go and make 500 updates on some items. The database on my server, or the website on my server alone, is over 20 gigabytes. A lot of that is video, one-of-a-kind video, and audio, and photos, but tons and tons of text. In addition, I utilize YouTube and have hundreds and hundreds of links to some video and audio of the Kenton Band. And then, of course, as I said, ongoing updates. I got an email this morning from a Kenton fan who found one little typo in one of my web pages. I love that. Other things I get from people, we'll see some of the donations as we go along the way. This is a table of contents, kind of gives you a sense, and I'll talk about some of these sections and show some of them. Some of them are pretty obvious. I have a pretty extensive genealogy of Kenton, if that interests you. I show about the UNT, University of North Texas Archives, with the listing. Videos of the Kenton Band. I've got all the significant videos that I could possibly find and put them up there, as well as videos of other bands and people doing tributes. There's a blog, it's not very active, but that's where I personally give a few comments on things. An extensive bibliography, photographs, a section on the arrangers. I think without the Kenton Band, without the arrangers, there is no Kenton Band, because they kind of set the tone for what he is. I do have this one section of the table of contents that may not seem exactly clear as to what it is, called adventures. That's where I just throw in things that I didn't have a place to put anywhere else. And you can see some of these things. Rendezvous 1999 or 2000, I have historic photos or videos of the videos of all the sessions of these two events in England, including a lot of Kenton personnel and alumni. If anything, go to those and check out the Milt Bernhardt panel. Not panel, but a solo talk where he talks about the history of the trombone and the Kenton band. He's one of the funniest men in jazz, and he gives anecdotes. Talk about a lady. In mid-1940, Stan Kenton's band was featured in a feature movie. Wasn't a very good movie, but we do get to see the band. We get to see Stan and his band in sombreros and Mexican costumes, and Gene Roland in June Christian costumes singing. Some of these are tours, and we'll look at a couple of these, or at least one of these. The Festival of Modern American Jazz was a tour Stan made for about a year and a half, where he had soloists such as Art Tatum, Dizzy Gillespie, Stan Getz, Charlie Parker, featured on concerts with the band. I have the complete tour of those, the complete details of those tours, as well as all known recordings of those tours. Other tours were the Progressive Jazz Tour and the 1956 European Tour, where I have the same kind of detailed events. The Los Angeles Neophonic Orchestra, I have every program with every personnel, every Downbeat review, every Los Angeles Times review, as well as a lot of other material from that. I have articles we're research interested in here. This is a series of articles that you can read. That first group were articles I wrote, published by IAJE and presented to that organization. The next group are liner notes that I've written for various CDs. And this final one, the dissertation by Bob Morgan, I took his original dissertation, I retyped it, reset all of his musical examples in Finale, and made a sort of a user-friendly version of his dissertation that goes into Bob Gravenger. The recordings are what we have to remember these bands by mostly. So I have an in-depth section on the recordings divided by the labels primarily, Capitol and Creative World being the main labels, but going through all these others, as well as dozens and dozens of live performances. Of the recordings, especially for Capitol and Creative, I go into a lot of detail. The cover art, of course, complete discographical material is included, dates, personnel, etc., liner notes for all the albums, reviews from all the major magazines from the albums, as well as the audio using YouTube links from that. Bibliography, full text articles to a lot of these available to you. Downbeat and Metronome being the primary sources as jazz history. I have full, and they're divided by categories, the blindfold test and things like that. Before I would jump in, that's a little background. Before I jump into the website itself and give you the actual tour, we leave the lobby of the museum. These are some of the tools that I used to create this. There are many other tools to do it. I taught myself web design. I don't write code, but I use a program called Rapid Weaver, and you'll see the results of that if you look in the page. There's a lot of plugins and things to make your page look really, really professional. FileMaker Pro is what I used. It's a relational database, meaning I could take one database of the recordings that Kent made, another one of the recording sessions, another one of the arrangements at University of North Texas, and have those all relate and cross-link with one another. There's so many photos on this, it would take forever to load the pages. So if you decide to do something like this, I recommend having something that's going to take your photos, make them smaller in bytes, much smaller, but not take away from the quality of the pictures. And I use JPEG Mini. Bookends is a bibliographic program I use. You probably are all familiar with Adobe Acrobat. Using the optical character recognition was very helpful for getting full text articles and scans. I'm a two-finger typist, so the more I could have some assistance in that process, the better. And then so many audio examples I've gotten. People donated, people send me a cassette where they held the microphone up in a concert someplace, and I have to do a lot of audio editing, and so I use this industry standard Pro Tools for that. So that's a little background. So I'd like to now open up the page itself and invite you to follow me down some of the halls. So here's where you'll start. If it seems overwhelming, there's a couple of shortcuts I can show you. On this home page, if you click on See What's New, and you can see some of the latest things that I've added. And just you go. I started making this What's New page only back about a little over a year ago. So there's a lot. The page has been going on for many, many years. But you can see some of the things that I've got here. For instance, Music 55. Music 55 was a television show that ran 10 episodes in the mid-50s in which Stan Kenton put a band together, Johnny Richards put a band together, Bart Barcelona was the contractor, and Bart's son, Joe, is a friend of mine. And so he provided me with these videos of two of the shows that hadn't been seen since 1955. And in the advertising for this, I promised you that I would show you historic videos, audios, and some photos. And I want to show you a little example of this.
Live from New York, Music 55.
Kent would fly in once a week, have a rehearsal with the band that Johnny Richards has been rehearsing. It's a New York studio band, it wasn't his band. They'd have guests each show. So I'm going to jump ahead to this one, to the one right here. You can see the guest here being Duke Ellington.
Duke, I know that you have to get away early for your aqua show, so if you don't mind, we would like to ask you if you'll appear first on the show.
Well, I'd like to.
And next, Duke, may I apologize for
Stanley Newcomb Kenton.
Duke, may I apologize for cutting that introduction a bit short. I said composer, arranger, and conductor. I should have said composer, arranger, conductor, and piano.
Yeah.
And Duke, this might be a magnificent opportunity for some of that practical demonstration here.
Yeah, but Stan, there's no... Fine, there's no piano yet.
Oh, Duke, there's a television piano piece.
Oh, yeah, but this is...
There we are.
Oh, that's Steinway. You know, I play Beckstein.
Oh, really? Beckstein, please, over here.
Oh, well.
Very good, Duke.
Well, they were that easy.
A little hesitant about solo on the piano, particularly when the courtesy of pianists were the Stan Kenton band.
You're wonderful. May I...
after you.
After me.
After you.
Well, let's see.
This is an ongoing collection, as I said, and I just received these videos from Joe Barcelona, as I said, just a couple months back. At this point, these are the only two shows that I've actually seen. There are 10 now. But as I said, this is a tease, so we're going to just give you a little bit. You know where to find it to see the rest of it. I do want to... there's several interesting things on this episode that you might not get to see elsewhere. Yehudi Menuhin in play with Duke Ellington accompanying him. Duke Ellington doing a narration to a composition that he wrote, where he's doing the narration, where there are Andy Warhol drawings being on the screen in the background. So it's some pretty fascinating things. Just to show you, on every page I try to get as much information as I can. So this started with just the two videos. Well, so I did some research. Took some articles from Michael Sparks' book as well as Chris Peary's book, The Personnel, the Downbeat review of the show, and this is the payroll sheet that Bart Barcelona was keeping for that. And then I did a little research, found out here were the guest artists on each episode. So whenever I pick up a new topic like this, I just try to go all in. Another thing that can help you get through this site, if you click on the table of contents, this was the slide I showed you with all these categories, you also see the See What's New button appears here as well. Also, if you're not sure, if you just want to go in and say, show me something interesting, I don't know where to start, this little square on the top gives you some examples. And every time you reload the page, it'll give you put a bunch in a random rotating thing and you can get, for instance, 2 months in Europe. This is the 1956 European tour. This came to me when a friend in England sent me a stack of photos No idea who the photographer was. He didn't know. He just had these original photos of the Stan Kenton Band while they were touring in Europe. So I started doing a research on this page. And you can find, here's the band as they've arrived. I mentioned this to Michael Spark, who's a good friend, and he decided just, he wrote me a very lengthy email on his views that turned into an essay that I posted here. Pictures of Lenny Niehaus and Curtis Counts in performance. The personnel listing. All the known audio of that exists of those shows and that tour is available here.
Stan Kenton kommer till Fornebu och får en öredövande mottagelse av kvinnliga och manliga jazzentusiaster och Kenton tillhängare. Orkestret på 35 man lyssnar till välkomsten.
But anyway, again, I'm just giving you some teasers here. Articles from the newspapers, reviews from the different magazines. Somebody sent me some ticket stubs to the concert that they had gone to in Britain. A few other things, headlines from Melody Maker, a program from that tour, more photographs. Jazz Journal covered this extensively, so a lot of articles there, more photos, and then a day-by-day itinerary. And what an exhausting tour. Virtually every day there was a concert, some days two concerts, both in England and in mainland. More photos. The passenger list from the Queen Elizabeth, listing Kenton as well as the members of his band, as well as the boat when it arrived back in New York. Here's the list. Some of my ancestry.com is a great source for those kinds of things. As I said, we're just kind of strolling down the hallway, and I want to make sure I hit some. One of my favorite areas is on the recordings I told you, just to give you a look of what that's about. For every Capitol record, you've got all the cover artwork right here. You click on any one of those and it brings you to the detail. Some of these I have a little essay or a little paragraph or two written. You want to read the liner notes, they're there for you. Downbeat review, metronome, billboard, the complete tracks and solos. One of my personal favorites, being an arranger, is I tried to make a notation about all the arrangers, because as I said earlier, the arrangers are really what created the sound. And this was a fun thing to do going through. I had a lot of help from Michael Spark on this, of looking at my list in details. I had a lot of help from folks like Bill Fritz, getting an accurate picture. Steve Spiegel, who wrote just a few charts for the band, including Hey Jude, wrote me a letter explaining how he got that commission and how it came about and why he didn't stay on. I have a list of all the arrangements and I have an example of audio from each of these arrangers. Some of these, as I said, were helped along. We can find various familiar faces here. Only a couple of pictures that I wasn't able to get hold of. Joe Riso, if anybody has a picture of him. And then one other section I want to show you, and then I think we're going to drop to some question time. In the same of the albums, and of course all the Capitol and all the Creative World albums, as well as the Mosaic and Naxos and all these other labels. Also, Kenton performed at the Newport Jazz Festival these times. You can listen to every recording there, as well as seeing this, the list of personnel and sometimes some photos. Other recordings, the Beatitudes, the Wedding in Monaco, where Stan Kenton put together the music for the marriage of Princess Grace. These are a lot of others. Some of these came to me, like this one, was something I bought on eBay, which was a cassette of the band playing 1 hour set in Disneyland. The great thing, I mean, all of this is great to me, but this arrangement of Up, Up and Away by Tom Senth doesn't exist anywhere else on any recording. So I'm really excited. I'm like that person that's going through the drawers in Vienna somewhere and they uncover a lost Mozart symphony, finding these things and filling in the gaps. There are so many, it goes in so many directions. On these radio recordings, these are another series of recordings, you can see that Kent was quite active, and if I just pick one of these, the Marine Ballroom, Steel Pier, he did a concert, a miniature concert. I try to get as many pictures just for color as I can. The personnel, all the soloists, as well as a recording of the whole concert, of all those radio shows. So I'm trying to keep track of time here. And one last section that I will show you, because I was really happy with the way it came out, was the singers. For the most, up until at least into the 1960s, Stan Kenton always had a singer. He had a lot of them. So this is one. It's interesting. The first piece that Stan Kenton ever recorded as a vocal was him singing St. James Infirmary. The last piece he recorded on a proper recording session, not just from one of these live things that I've got, was him singing St. James Infirmary. So that kind of... But there I've divided, and this is where the plugins helped, of having these singers. And I've gone through and you look and see, like June Christie, for instance. I've got pictures, I've got the time she was on, if there's an obituary. I've got a little essay I wrote about it. I've got some reviews, lines from Downbeat and Metronome. I've got two recordings of her playing. I've got a listing of all the arrangements she sang with the Kenton Band, links to the albums that she was on, as well as songs that she sang with the Kenton Band in which were never recorded, as well as some final photos. So again, I do feel like I'm like racing you through my museum and pointing through doors and saying, hey, check this out and check this out, hoping that you'll have some time on your own to go and revisit this and spend a little more time. Don't be afraid to just go in and get lost down that rabbit hole, because there's something to me and to anybody that's interested in Kenton around every corner that's really exciting. If you have any updates, if you have any programs or you have any information you want included in this website, please let me know. On the bottom of every page, there's a contact me button that'll open up your email program and you can send me an email. If you find errors, as tiny as a typo, a misspelled word, a missed period, I like to be kind of anal about that and fix it. But in particular, if you have any kind of that one-of-a-kind material that you'd like to be available to anybody that is interested in Stan Kenton, please contact me. There's a little information in these flyers, that there's some in the back and there's some up front. If you just have any questions or memories of Kenton that you think you want to share with somebody that would enjoy it, please talk to me afterwards, find me at the conference, or shoot me an email. So with that, I think we got maybe a minute or two if anybody has any questions on that. Yes?
Do you want like autographs of the band members?
I'll find a place. You know, no, with that question, I don't know where. I'd have to find the proper place. If it was an instrumentalist, I might put on that page. If I get enough of one thing, sometimes I create a whole new page of those things. So yes, I'm interested in all things Kenton.
Also, is there, do you have like a where are they now?
No, the closest thing I have to that is if you go to the table of contents in this bio and links page, where I have a list of his awards and some different links, and I have this of Kenton alumni home pages. So these are ones that I made aware of living Kenton rock people, not historical tribute pages where they're active. And I try to update that. And again, people will send me updates to that, and I'll add them in if you have anything like that. Yes?
Do you have a running personnel list?
That has been, somebody suggested I do that, and I did it. The instrumentalist, it can never be complete. So many people filled in for a week at a theater in Detroit, yeah, right? And we'll never know. But I tried to make it as complete as I could, and I put links on some of these. And this has been something where somebody has sent me and said, hey, you forgot about me. Or, you know, my friend was on the band for one summer. I had to make judgment calls. If you filled in for a night, do you make the list? I say no. It's my list. If you were older, you know, people have argued and said, no, if you ever played one night with the Kenton Band or one song, you should be on the list. Well, I played a dozen songs sitting in it on bass at rehearsals that I'm not on the Kenton Band and I shouldn't be. Also, if you were only in the studio and were not on one of the Stan Kenton orchestras, I didn't include you. But this list I don't think will ever be complete. It's just I put it up as best as I could. All right, well, I think we probably have to move on, but thank you, everybody.
Jazz Education Network, we present this snazzy certificate, which we hope you will scan and include. And we thank you for this work.
So that's, you know, that's what I'm talking about.